konferencija se dešava u okviru projekta mreža nevladinih organizacija za održivo korišćenje prirodnih resursa i održivu energetiku na zapadnom Balkanu i Turskoj. Projekat je započeo u decembru prošle godine i cilj konferencije je da nam predstavimo svim učesnicima šta se do sad radilo u ovom projektu istraživanja, gde smo sada u odnosu na aproksimaciju prema Evropskoj uniji u ovim oblastima, šta su mesta na kojima civilno društvo može da pomogne u tom javnom zagovaranju i koje su nam mogućnosti da aktivno delujemo da bi se desilo poboljšanja u ovim oblastima. Konferencija će obaviti više od 80 učesnika iz zemalja Zapadnog Balkana, Turske i naravno iz zemalja Evropske unije, iz kojih su mali ćemo prikazivati primere dobre prakse i primere iz zemalja koji su malo otišli naprednije od nas u procesu aproksimacije. Pa vidimo kako je tamo civilno društvo uticalo i na proces pregovora vezano za 27 poglavlje da smo zaživljavali. Družit ćemo se 3 dana ovde na Paliću
u Stavoni.
I rezultate konferencije ćemo se učiniti u Jadru na web stranicama kako zelena akcija koja je glavno osnovi organizacija, tako i CEKOR, koji je organizacija partner ispred Srbije, a u ovom projektu imamo i druge partnere koji su i međunarodni, Friends of the Earth International, Friends of the Earth Europe, Henrik Bell Fondacija, Centar za ekologiju i energiju, Bosne, Centar za životnu sredinu i Green Home iz Crne Gore. Znači, jedan veliki projekat koji će trajati 2 godine, mi smo na samom početku, predstavit ćemo i male grantove koji će se u okviru ovog projekta biti u vladinim organizacijama i znači moći će se postaviti pitanje da li uputstva, jer ovaj poziv za male grantove traje još uvek oko 8 godina. Ovde imamo danas preko 80 učesnika iz zemalja Zapadnog Balkana, jednu učesnicu iz Turske i dosta govornika i osoba koje dolaze iz zemalja Evropske unije. Izuzetno mi je drago da smo svi danas gosti na Paliću, na ovom jezeru blizu Subotice, i da ćemo imati prilike da govorimo o temama održive energije i o temi održivog upravljanja prirodnim resursima. Imamo i tu koincidenciju da nam je evo u isto vreme, na istom mestu, sednica odbora Skupštinskog odbora za zaštitu životne sredine koje se danas bavi znači, pitanjem zagađenja poljoprivrednog zemljišta i zagađenja voda. Da smo ranije znali, mogli smo da napravimo neki možda bolji miks, ali evo čas mi je da pozdravim gospođu Milicu Bojić-Marković, predsjednicu ovog odbora, da nam se, eto, barem toliko malo obrati ispred, znači, ovog odbora sa kojima i kroz zelenu stolicu postoji lepa saradnja sa civilnim društvom.
Hvala, Nataša. Neće to biti obraćanje. Ja sam prosto ovde svoja među svojima i hoću da kažem nekoliko ličnih stvari. Da se predstavim, prvo ja sam Milica Vojić-Marković, predsednica sam odbora za zaštitu životne sredine u parlamentu Srbije. Neki od učesnika su juče bili na našem prvom sastanku koji se održava takođe ovde. Dakle, šta je Odbor za zaštitu životne sredine prepoznao? Prepoznao je da on ne može biti kompetentan za mnoge oblasti koje su potpuno granične i koje se preklapaju sa nekim drugim oblastima. Jedna od tih oblasti jeste poljoprivreda, tako da su dva skupštinska odbora, Odbor za poljoprivredu i Odbor za zaštitu životne sredine, napravili jedan zajednički sastanak sa željom da dođemo upravo u jednu lokalnu zajednicu, došli smo u Suboticu, da razgovaramo o problemima koji nastaju u primjeni zakona, da vidimo gde zakoni škripe, jer znate, kad donosite zakone, vi ih donosite sa jednim ciljem, a onda se oni okrenu na neku drugu stranu, pa ne možete da ih pratite. Dakle, i poslanici prate te zakone koje su doneli da vide kako oni izgledaju u praksi. Juče smo pokušali da dobijemo odgovore na neka pitanja. Jedno od centralnih pitanja, naravno od nas iz oblasti zaštite životne sredine, je svakako upozorenje kako će se rešiti pitanje jezera Palić. To je veliko upozorenje, naravno da prevazilazi snage lokalne zajednice, naravno da prevazilazi i snage države u mnogo čemu, pa i u znanju, pa i u materijalnim sredstvima. I zbog toga smo prosto hteli da osnažimo lokalnu zajednicu, da kažemo niste sami ljudi, iako se osjećaju sami, verovatno jesu u najvećem delu sami. Hoćemo da pomognemo, hoćemo da te stvari gledamo svi zajedno i da pokušamo da ih rešimo. Na isti način, pošto je to naravno jedno vrlo kompleksno pitanje koje dodiruje i komunalne politike, dodiruje poljoprivredu, dodiruje energetiku, dodiruje mnogo šta, onda smo pokušali da problem vidimo sa različitih aspekata. Vidim iz onog što sam popričala sa vašim organizatorima ovog skupa danas da vi na isti način razgovarate, to je divno, jer prvo vidim da su ekolozi vrlo aktivni. To znači da pratimo šta se dešava, to znači da ćemo primenjivati Arhusku konvenciju, da ćemo naterati državu da je primenjuje pre svega, i to znači da ćemo na svoj način, uz znanje, strpljenje, mir jedan, uspeti da regulišemo mnoga pitanja koja su u ovoj zemlji od vitalnog značaja. Znam za mnoge skupove danas i prošle nedelje, i odbori učestvuju u nekim prošle nedelje, tako da sam vrlo zadovoljna što mi možemo da pomognemo u tom smislu da budemo danas ovde, ako je to uopšte pomoć. Ja samo prosto želim da vam poželim srećan rad, da vam kažem da u parlamentu, u Odboru za zaštitu životne sredine imate svoju zelenu stolicu i ovde vidim neke koji su mi vrlo aktivni na toj zelenoj stolici. Dakle, vi sami birate predstavnike koji će doći kada je određena tema na dnevnom redu odbora, a svaka sednica ima svoju zelenu stolicu, znači ne biramo mi sagovornike, vi birate ko su adekvatni sagovornici koji će doći, da poželi našu zajedničku saradnju da bude još uspešnija, jer postoji mnogo stvari koje još možemo da uradimo zajedno. Odbor i ja sama prepoznaje civilni sektor kao svog partnera, prirodnog partnera, i trudit ću se da otvorim vrata odbora za sve ono što može da prinese boljitku u ovoj državi. Znači, nemam predrasuda ni političkih, ni partijskih, ni ideoloških, ni bilo kojih drugih, ako se u ovoj oblasti mi slažemo i imamo različite mišljenje, i to je sjajno. Ni toga se ne bojim. Moram da idem na današnju sesiju odbora, jer vodim ja danas ovaj sastanak, a s obzirom da nismo uspeli da nateramo institucije da nam dođu u vreme kada su pozvani, Uprava za poljoprivredno zemljište se juče nije pojavilo, tako da stotinak ljudi nije dobilo odgovore na svoje pitanja. Danas ih očekujemo. To znači da ja danas moram da prepakujem svoj dnevni red i da izvedem sastanak kako treba, tako da nemojte mi uzeti za zlo što je to kao došla, otvorila i pobegla. Imam tamo zaista prilično komplikovanu situaciju da je razrešimo, kako ćemo to danas izvesti u 3 sata, ali želim vam srećan rad, pa ako uspem još da malo pobegnem kod vas, jako ću rado. Tamo je tako prilično kamerna i zvanična atmosfera, ova mi više prija. Hvala vam.
Hvala gospođi Vojić Marković. Imam čast da predstavim i Takso Srbiju, Zoricu Rašković, koja će da isto kaže par reči, a imat ćemo prilike i kasnije po podnevnoj sesiji da čujemo malo više šta se Takso radi i kako oni pružaju tehničku pomoć organizacijama i inače i u okviru ovog kola podrške IPA regionalnog poziva za civilno društvo.
Hvala lepo na poverenju da govorim odmah i pre vas koji ste zapravo ovde važni i pre projekta koji predstavljate ovde zajedno kao mreže, pojedinci, eksperti, ekspertkinje iz čitavog regiona. Dakle, ja sam nacionalna savjetnica takso projekta za Srbiju. Pretpostavljam, znate, svi smo mi samo ljubivi pomalo, da većina vas zapravo zna šta je takso, jer je takso prisutan u regionu već 4 godine, ali eto, nekako dužnost nalaže da kažem, barem osnovno, znači takso je projekat Civil Society Facility-a, odnosno jednog programa u Direktoratu za proširenje koji se malo neprevodivo na lokalne jezike zove Civil Society Facility, odnosno podrška razvoju civilnog društva. To je jedna od komponenti tog programa koji ima za cilj da ojača ulogu civilnog društva u regionu i pa zemljama, znači u regionu Zapadnog Balkana i Turskoj, plus evo sada odnedavno Islandu koji je deo takso male porodice. Jača ulogu, pre svega ulogu participativnoj demokratiji, kako bismo rekli, demokratskim procesima koji podrazumevaju aktivnu ulogu organizacija civilnog društva. Prva faza takso 1 se završio u avgustu i on je imao dostignuća svoje naučene lekcije i negde na temelju toga je napravljen novi poziv, novi tender SIPU kao liderska organizacija za implementaciju ovog projekta zajedno s konzorcijom partnerima dobila šansu da još 4 godine vodi takso u regionu i mi se nadamo da će naša saradnja u budućnosti biti još veća i još bolja i kvalitetnija. Znači, osnovna ideja jeste veze između taksoa i Framework Partnership Agreements, odnosno vaših projekata, okvirnih sporazuma, partnerskih sporazuma, da ih ne mogu nazvati projektima, oni zaista jesu sporazum, oni zaista jesu neka vrsta velikih koalicija ili velikih task forces za region u određenoj oblasti. I nekako imamo posebno zadovoljstvo i moj kolega i ja što smo došli na jednu od njih koji nam se čini onako najsnažniji i potpuno jasno, sa jasnom idejom šta zapravo želi. Nedavno smo imali priliku da vidimo i u zgradi Palati Srbije da je dobar deo ljudi iz Srbije, iz regiona, bio prisutan na jednoj od prvih konferencija koja je posvećena ulozi uključivanja civilnog društva u procese pregovaranja u pristupanju Evropskoj uniji u Srbiji. Mislim da ekspertiza koja nose vaši ljudi, vaše organizacije sigurno će biti jako dobro prepoznata, uvažena i korišćena u tom procesu. S druge strane, takso želi da je na vama na raspolaganju da one, uslovno da kažem tehničku, za svu vrstu tehničke asistencije, za dodatno povezivanje, za dodatnu razmenu, za podršku ukoliko je ona potrebna i mislimo da smo tu, da kažem, na istom nekako poslu. Da civilno društvo bude prepoznatljivije, uvaženije, a to može samo tako što će kvalitet usluga koje oni daju, zapravo koje mi dajemo, biti bolji. I to je nekako naš osnovni zadatak.
Dakle, ovaj projekt zapravo se zove vrlo velikog imena, pa smo mi napravili ovu skraćenicu ETNAR, Energy Transport Natural Resources, jer je on fokusiran, zove se inače Advocacy NGOs Network for Sustainable Use for Energy and Natural Resources in the Western Balkans and Turkey. Oops. So today we are here at the, next slide please, at the regional conference with aim, actually the 4 goals of the conference are to present the research done so far and the issues of natural resources and energy and climate in the region, with focus on 4 countries where we've done the most work so far, and they are Serbia, Montenegro, Bosnia and Herzegovina, and Croatia. To present the call for the sub-grantees, we will have a call, actually it's open already, and it's going to close in October, to submit project proposals under this big project. To provide basic education and exchange about EU horizontal legislation for NGOs, and to identify networking and cooperation priorities in the region. project itself, it's already mentioned, has many partners. They are listed on the next slide. As you can see, for these countries in the region, plus some European partners like Friends of the Earth International, Friends of the Earth Europe, and Hannibal Stiftung from Germany, with their branches, with their offices in Sarajevo and Zagreb. The project itself is going to last maybe 4 years. I'll say this later, but the idea is maybe to spread the cooperation in the region in a way that we invite more NGOs to become partners in the next stage, or just to cooperate through these small grants. The idea for the project came based on our experience to work in this region, and we had successfully completed two regional projects. One was related also to capacity building and networking among environmental NGOs in Southeastern Europe, and it was funded by Dutch government, and we also had these small grants for campaigning. And second one was networking and capacity building of environmental NGOs to increase energy efficiency on renewable resources of energy in Western Balkans, with focus on regional cooperation among NGOs on energy issues, and we have formed a regional network, CNET. Next one. Thank you. We are a good team, eh? The objectives of the project is to increase capacity of NGOs in the Western Balkans and Turkey to influence EU environmental approximation process through the public advocacy supported by citizens. We had a dilemma, should we include Turkey, because we didn't work much with Turkey. It's kind of Balkan countries kind of more tied together, and also the language issue is kind of advantage, because if you can communicate not only in English, it's easier to work. But we opened up to Turkey because in future we would like to increase our cooperation. And the second objective is to increase capacities of NGOs in the Western Balkans and Turkey to influence policies related to energy. So it's also not only capacity building, it's also enabling civil society to make, to impact on decision makers in the region on the policy related to this issue. Results: to strengthen regional policy networking of NGOs on energy, transport, nature resources. So we hope that the networks will increase their work. To improve capacity of environmental NGOs in policy analysis, policy monitoring, and public advocacy. To increase legitimacy of NGOs on energy, transport, nature resources policy, and enhance dialogue with national stakeholders. So basically, we want to have this cooperation with decision makers, but also other stakeholders, and we will have some national activities in each country where these policies and position papers are going to be presented to other stakeholders, like on national debates or national roundtables, something like that. To improve networking among environmental NGOs from the Western Balkans and Turkey with EU-wide environmental networks and NGOs. So basically, we do have these European partners, and like Hannibal Foundation, which is very present in the region, and they provide very, very good policy analysis, which we can use in our daily work. But also there is Friends of the Earth International and its branch, Friends of the Earth Europe, that has member groups only in Croatia and Macedonia, in whole region now, but we are open to, in future, have more members of the network in the region. And before that, we are open for any kind of cooperation. Next one, please. Okay, activities. I will not read all of this. You see how many of activities there are? So I put them in different shape, because just to stress some of those. So all the call that of this this project, so when they designed the call for the project, they said it's unusual, because they said first you have up to 6 months of preparation phase where you're going to do some analysis to see is your idea good enough. You have to discuss it with other stakeholders. And then after these 6 months you will have implementation phase. So some of these activities have been done, and they were not so visible in public because they were mostly research. We have done this energy and trust policy analysis, so we try to collect what we have, data that we have in the four countries of project partners in the region, to see what is the legislation related to energy and natural resources, what are the policies national, what are the problems, such stuff. And you'll get the presentations later, tomorrow. Then the red activities are those who are currently under implementation. More you will hear also later. The one that is especially stressed with this underlying is the subgrants, which is probably the most interesting for you to apply. We started the project with a press conference in Zagreb in January this year when we announced the cooperation in the region. Also, there was in Brussels a meeting with all grantees from the COP. There are a few grantees related to environment, and we also invited some of them here, and they are here with us. So you'll hear later what they do. I already started to say about time frame. So the inception phase ended up in May this year. And the implementation phase started already and is going to end up in November 2014. But there is a possibility, very likely a possibility, I would say, that the project continues for the next 2 years. So it's 2 plus 2 years total. And the good thing, which is very unique about EU-funded projects, is that it's a bit more flexible. So we can, if we learn something that is good in the project implementation, some activities have shown better results, some of them maybe not so, because design was not so good, or because of some circumstances that we couldn't see in advance, then we can propose to Commission to change the second part of the project. And also, there is no guarantee that we will get the second part, but I expect we will, particularly if we do have good results in the first 2 years. So in terms of like cooperation in the region, it's really good to know that there is some kind of time frame of 4 years of some funding and 4 years of possibility to work together. But that also means that probably Commission has some high expectations of the results. So what are the results of the first six months? In this consultation process, we also presented project to some EU parliamentarians, and they are kind of interested in cooperation, like the green parliamentarians in EU Parliament, which is good, because in this time before you join EU, or now for Croatia when we are in EU, it's very good to have direct connection with some parliamentarians, because you learn policy, what's happening there, what are going to be policy changes in EU, and also you can also influence your own governments in the accession process. We'll speak about how it was done in Croatia, Slovenia, and now it's in Montenegro about this accession and involvement of non-governmental organizations in the process, but I can say from the experience of Croatia, it was very useful time to influence national government and national legislation in the process of accession. So basically, we also have consulted 65 NGOs through the questionnaire. So some of you maybe have filled it, some of you remember what your answers were. So it was 65 NGOs from the whole region that responded to our questionnaires, which was a bit more than we planned. We planned 50, but there is different distribution from the countries. So. Okay, next slide. On this slide, you can see, now I'm going to present some of the results from this questionnaire analysis. You see the distribution. Out of 65, we have the biggest percentage from Serbia, and a bit less from other countries. This doesn't allow us to have national analysis, so the sample is too small. Maybe for Serbia we could have national analysis because it's big enough, but for others we just didn't make any analysis on national level. We kind of made analysis of the results on a regional level for all together. Maybe in future, if we decided to have another round of questionnaires to compare what's the difference, it will be interesting then to have national analysis too. Next one. I hope that you can see. It's a bit very, very big graph, and it's far away. But basically, this graph shows analysis of a couple of questionnaires. The first one was on which of these issues you are working, and there was offer of different issues, many of them, so people could tick. And then the second question, which is in red, the first one is in blue. The red question was if you don't work on this issue, but you would like to work on issue, which are these issues? So for instance, if Zelena Akcija is working on not working on river protection, but you would like to work in next couple of years on river protection, then it's in the second question. So you see that maybe the most, the biggest numbers in terms of topics that NGOs in the regions are interested, either by working or would like to work, are those in related to public participation in environmental decision making, biodiversity, Natura 2000 and other ecological networks, renewable energy, and energy efficiency. In terms of those topics that some NGOs would like to work, so the answer that they would like to work, but they're not working higher, or they would like to work in future. So that means areas of work which are expected to be increased are, let's say, in renewables, for instance, and then in water privatization and protection. For instance, in the strategic environmental assessment and environmental impact assessment, same. So there are many NGOs who already work on these issues, but there are more of those who don't, but they would like to work in next couple of years. So for us, this is very good notice in which direction of education or capacity building we should go. So we could focus on those issues that groups are not working now, but they would like to. The next one. We also asked them on three main topics, which are the focus of this project, that is energy, transport, and natural resources. We asked them two questions. First one was on which do work on these issues in terms of environmental campaigning, like advocacy campaigning. That means that you want to have some policy change or stop a project that is damaging to environment, something like that. So that was the first question. The second question was, do you plan to work on these campaigns and how many? So you see these three lines. The black line shows the campaigns in the last 2 years. So you can see that most of the NGOs said, yes, we work on natural resources. Fewer answered, yes, we work on energy issues. And the fewest answered, yes, we work on transport. The red line shows those who said, we will work in next couple of years. So you see this, the numbers are higher. So we expect that NGOs in the region increase the level of work. And then green one is strength, the difference. So the biggest increase we expect the biggest increase we expect in a field of energy, actually. Next one. We asked them, okay, if you don't work on something but you would like to work, why you don't? So what are the problems? What are the obstacles? So as you can see on this graph, the most people answered that the reason why they don't work on something is that they lack financial or human resources. And then the other answers were, we lack expertise, technical knowledge, this is the second. So maybe we can help on the boat. I mean, we don't have, we can give small grants, but not much more that we have. But maybe commission will increase the funding in the region for these answers. And second answers, we could help also with providing more knowledge. Also, Taxo can help with the technical knowledge, and we can help with more like content knowledge. Lack of reliable data. So that means that you don't have enough data about something, and it came really high in comparison with other. And then the other reasons are lack of partnerships in which you are involved, lack of monitoring capacity, lack of experience in public campaigning or advocacy actions, a lack of lobbying competencies, and lack of experience in media work. You see just 1% of civil society organizations think that they have problems with that. So we asked them also, if you would like to have more education, capacity building, which would be priority areas? And we gave them five possibilities. And they could rank them 1, 2, 3. So they couldn't say, so we want to see which are the biggest priority, because usually people say everything or something like that. So the red line shows the first place. So how many times this topic has been put on the first place by how many NGOs? So basically you can see the red line. The highest need of priority for capacity building would be education about EU horizontal environmental legislation. The second one is policy monitoring and shadow reporting. So this is kind of this technical policy stuff related to EU. The third one is public advocacy tools. These are tools like how you make public advocacy campaign, what you can use to get results and such. Fourth was mobilization and management of volunteers, and fifth was media work. That is number one place, the first place. Then the blue line shows the second place. So how many times this topic showed at the second place? And you can see again that on second place, the highest numbers got EU horizontal environmental legislation, then policy monitoring and shadow reporting, then mobilization. And so it got a bit kind of flattened. And the gray line is the third place, and you see that it's kind of like average. It's more like it's not going up and down so much. One of the reasons why it's so flat, the gray line, is that many NGOs couldn't make their choices, so they just say that everything, we need education on everything without ranking. So we put everything on number three. We also asked them in the questionnaire what are the urgent needs, number two, number three, that you need to improve your work. And this was free answering. So basically, you could write anything that you wanted. If there was no choices that you just choose. So as you can see, On the first place, it was financial resources. When we collected data, we put them in a group. So some people were more elaborated in their answers, some of them have been less, but financial resources are the most needed to improve the world. And human resources, like a lack of people, also. Then we had lack of experience or skills in public campaigns, advocacy, education and training of activists and volunteers. Building partnership with NGOs, that also came reasonably high. And then there are other stuff, like technical capacity, media, and so on. On the second place, in terms of importance, again, we have financial resources and funding. But here we also get some proposals, like we maybe have funding, but it's project funding, and we need more non-restricting income, like different type of funding that will give us more freedom to do what is priority work. Then we have lack of experience and skills in public campaigns, then human resources and so on. I was kind of surprised that maybe not first three of those, but like on fourth place always we came, like building partnerships with NGOs or networking and so on. So although we haven't offered this an option, it came naturally in answers, which I was surprised it came so high. I was not surprised that financial resources finally came on the first place. That's always something that comes on the first place. But it's good to know that NGOs in the region think that it's important to network and cooperate without any external kind of push. On the third level of needs, here is building partnerships with NGOs came first. For instance, those first one and two were probably like financial resources and human resources. The third one came, building partnership. As I said, it surprised me a bit, but it's also good to know. I think it's good to show that we are doing very needed work. For media and PR, I already said earlier that NGOs say that we don't need more capacity building or that. That doesn't necessarily mean that we are all very good in working in media. It means that we do work with media. In our work, we have to work with media. Here, there were some also good examples of the problems of working in media. One of them was like how you communicate environmental issues in the media, because they're not interested in that, or they're interested in just in scandals or something like that. And for instance, here it says there is a problem of financing the media, which are today like the civil sector in crisis, and it's very difficult to ensure their contribution to the project if a good part of the costs are not funding. And they need training of working with media. But also they answered about media, the privatization of media. It's really problematic, the mainstream. Then we also asked them, okay, these were your needs, but if you would like to offer something, what are your skills? What you have that you can offer other civil society organizations in the regions, like your expertise? So we wanted to know like if there we would develop some kind of exchange program or something like that, that what NGOs would be willing to teach others. So they said the management and operation of NGOs, how NGOs are formed, how they operate on a daily basis, that's something that they mastered and they could teach others. Then second place was experience with campaigns on certain issues, but also answer none came to that place. So some of them think that they have nothing to share in terms of knowledge with others because they don't have capacity or they don't know. Media work came here also, which is really this showing the same similarity with the previous results. On the second place, they said experience in working with the media, including public speaking, lobbying, and experience with campaigns on certain issues. Then it came like expertise in protected areas and web design, such stuff. And skill number three, again, media work. So here you can see what are the things under media work: moderating discussions, public relations, administration of social networks, and such stuff. So obviously that's something that in the region, civil society organizations that don't need more capacity building, most of them, and those who have this experience can share it with others. It is good to know. Second thing that we have done this analysis of situation on topics in four countries. I will not go into details because each project partner is going to present it tomorrow morning, what they found, but just some of the similarities that came out that may be interesting to for you to prepare for tomorrow's discussion. So these are things that we have actually analyzed. In energy, we have noticed the trend of investments in coal and big hydropower plants, and there were even some cross-border projects. So when I say in the region, I'm speaking now of these four countries: Serbia, Bosnia and Herzegovina, Montenegro, and Croatia. But we already know that in other countries that are not in this analysis, we have similar trends, and we will discuss this tomorrow in details. Energy to EU market, particularly those countries who are not, Croatia is not maybe so much because it's already in EU market, but other countries that are now on the border, very close, there is a lot of pressure for that. We identify the need to support local communities in stopping those projects, and need to have alternative energy strategies. In natural resources, here you can also see what we have looked at. So we looked at the legislation, what's there, how it's related to EU legislation, what are the differences. International agreements and also the data about natural resources which you could find. So we didn't do it was just a collection of data, it was not really in-depth scientific work. And then we had some case studies too. In terms of common issues, we identified a problem that is present, and that's water privatization and pollution. Again, pressure on rivers for big hydro, because usually these hydropower plants are planned in the nature protected areas or next to it or such stuff. Commercialization of protected areas, it's also problematic. Then we had some issues that were not shared by all countries, but some of them. But we could maybe explore tomorrow what is the situation on these in other countries. One is related to land grab and conversion of agricultural land into construction land. Second is coastal development and urbanization on the coast. And forest cut clearing, poaching, and such issues. So these are issues that maybe we can see in depth what's the situation in other countries. But also we conclude that we need a more in-depth research because for natural resources, it's so many of them and there are different situations among them, so we need more information. Right, now I'm getting back to this implementation phase which we are now. We also had seminar on dirty energy at Island of Sholta this July, and outputs of discussion is going to be presented in the energy workshop tomorrow. We have a design project website, Facebook, and leaflet. Leaflet is somewhere back there on also other materials somewhere back there on the table behind you. So you can take whatever you like. We opened this call for proposal for sub-granting. I hope you have seen it. It's published on our website. And the last day of this conference, we are going to go through the application form and through the guidelines to give you more information and maybe instruction how to fill it. And if you will have any questions related to the possibility of projects that you would like to submit, you can also ask them. Then we have a regional conference on environmental and taxation investment in Turkey, which is right now. And a legal toolkit, which will be a booklet collecting legislation in EU, in national countries, which we will publish and you can use it in your work. The next steps in this project will be selection of campaigns,
After the end of the call, it is going to be October, November. We will start to work, project partners will have national campaigns on national level in their countries. Then we also plan to have national trainings, panels to influence decision makers. That is a meeting of NGOs in particularly these four countries, and then meeting with other stakeholders in these four countries so that we do have work on national level. And this education and will be done by project partners in their countries with some maybe help with other partners. So if you need expertise from other partner, that person will come. And most of the education is going to be in national language. So we, because of this language, we wanted to have this education lower. So for smaller NGOs who cannot communicate in English, they cannot go for maybe this conference, international one, but they work in the very local level back home and they need more information. So that's the idea. So we have this networking in the region, one level of cooperation, and kind of deepening cooperation on national level, going back to the roots, going to the ground. So that's the idea of the project. I would like to also like to invite you on seminar on NGO environmental legislation. So that will be today and tomorrow. We will touch just the bits of EU environmental legislation, just introduction. For more in-depth education, we will provide a seminar. It's going to be in Montenegro somewhere in May.
Također kao i CEPOR smo partneri u projektu CISEPO kome ćete čuti mnogo više. Također trenutno radimo još na 4 IPA projekta. Zatim imamo projekte u partnerstvu sa WWF-om. Možda dovoljno što se tiče projekata, također bih pomenula da smo u našem radu posvećeni jačanju kapaciteta lokalnih NVO-a, posebno u Crnoj Gori, gdje pokušavamo da izgradimo određene mreže kroz koje ćemo osnažiti pojedinačno NVO-e, a onda omogućiti da se naš glas bolje čuje, tako da možda dvije najaktivnije mreže u Crnoj Gori koje mi koordiniramo su Natura 2000 Info Centar i Zeleni resursni centar koji okupljaju po nekih 30 organizacija i posebno ovaj Zeleni resursni centar u Srbiji u stvari ima bazu podataka što se tiče crnogorske i evropske legislative o vlasti životne sredine, također direktive Evropske unije prevedene na naš jezik.
Mi u stvari partnera ovom projektu ispred Republike Srpske, kolega iz Tuzle iz Centra za ekologiju i energiju je partner koji pokriva dio Federacije Bosne i Hercegovine, u stvari zajedno koordinisano radimo o čitave Bosne i Hercegovine. Centar za životnu sredinu se u stvari kroz svoje aktivnosti nekako bavi sa 4 glavne teme koje smo tako podijelili u 4 programa. To su energije i klimatske promjene, transport, biodiverzitet i zaštićena područja i održive zajednice. Ja lično koordinišem program biodiverzitet i zaštićena područja. U praksi to u stvari se dosta prepliče upravo sa pitanjima energije, zato što radimo dosta kampanja protiv, na primjer, hidroelektrana, isto tako i termoelektrana, ali ovaj dio hidroelektrana se upravo dotiče u najvećoj mjeri zaštićenim područjima. Pokrenuli smo osnivanje nekih koalicija u Bosni i Hercegovini, kao što su koalicije za zaštitu rijeke Sane i Vrbasa. To ću reći samo kao primjer nekih od naših aktivnosti, gdje u stvari su kampanje pokrenute upravo da bi se spriječila izgradnja hidroelektrana na ovim rijekama, ali kroz samu kampanju smo se onda usmjerili i na zagovaranje zaštite ovih područja, što je veliko pitanje u Bosni i Hercegovini, zato što je samo oko 1% države pod zaštitom, a veoma veći procenat ima u stvari opravdanost da se zaštiti.
Pa Zelena akcija je najveća organizacija zaštite okoliša u Hrvatskoj, stara 23 godine sad već. Imamo stvarno širok raspon područja na kojem radimo i okupljamo velik tim stručnjaka koji rade u uredu, ali isto tako uvijek se brinemo da oko tog stručnog tima imamo okupljen i velik broj volontera, to jest aktivista, pošto je taj aktivistički dio stvarno važan u našem radu. Pokušavamo uvijek spojiti, kao što sam već rekao, profesionalni tim sa volonterima koji nam daju jako veliku podršku u našem radu. Neću puno pričati o projektima evropskima i drugima, proveli smo ih jako puno, trenutno osim ovoga vodim još dvije IPA. Međunarodna suradnja nam je isto tako jako važan dio našeg rada, pa smo članovi velikog broja evropskih i svjetskih mreža. Jagoda koja je ovdje s nama, možda ona to nije spomenula, je nedavno postala članica najveće mreže za zaštitu okoliša na svijetu, to je Friends of the Earth International, koji ima članice do 70. Neću ni ja puno duljiti, htio bih samo spomenuti neke aktivne kampanje koje trenutno vodimo, pošto osim provođenja projekata nekako identificiramo se kao organizacija koja vodi aktivne kampanje javnog zagovaranja na području zaštite okoliša. Pa trenutno imamo, imamo veliku kampanju protiv termoelektrane Plomin na Jadranskoj obali. Imamo par tekućih kampanja oko hidroelektrana isto u kršu. Jednu smo nedavno uspješno i zatvorili i uspjeli izbaciti IBRD iz financiranja hidroelektrane Ombla pored Dubrovnika, tako da se nadamo da ćemo i u ostalima koje godine biti uspješni. Eto, ukratko hvala. Ako ima nekih pitanja, dosta nas je zelena akcija ovdje, pa možete slobodno pitati.
Hvala
vam. Pa evo, kad smo već pomenuli termoelektrane, ne mogu da ne pohvalim i CERCOR. Mi smo uspjeli IBRD da izbacimo iz Kolubare B. Nedavno smo to i proslavili, tako da vrlo smo aktivno radili na toj kampanji i naravno nastavljamo i dalje, ne samo oko Kolubare B, nego i oko drugih stvari. U toku je izrada nove energetske strategije za Srbiju i tu smo isto aktivni i daćemo svoj doprinos. Sada Jagoda, predsjednica Friends of the Earth International, da nam predstavi organizaciju Friends of the Earth International, a i Friends of the Earth Europe, koje su isto partneri, međunarodni partneri na ovom projektu.
Dakle, Friends of the Earth International je najveća mreža udruga za zaštitu okoliša u svijetu. Od ovih ostalih velikih, kao što su Greenpeace i WWF, razlikuje to što mi smo prvenstveno mreža nacionalnih članica. U svakoj zemlji gdje imamo članicu imamo jednu organizaciju, samo u tom smislu smo vrlo zahtjevni u smislu učlanivanja, kriteriji su vrlo visoki. I onda djelova poput malog UN-a, jer sve ide od ozdola prema gore se gradi. Mreža je osnovana 71. godine, proslavila je nedavno 40 godina rada. U tih 40 godina naravno imali smo i svoj razvojni put. Od četiri osnivačice, nastala je tako da su četiri organizacije nacionalno osnovale mrežu, sada ih imamo 74 i većina ih je sa takozvanog globalnog juga. Tijekom zadnjih 10 godina imali smo vrlo intenzivnu internu debatu oko strateškog planiranja, kako smo organizirani kao mreža, kako napraviti tu demokratičnost unutar mreže i decentralizaciju, zastupljenost jednakom jednu svih regija. Imamo izvršni odbor od 8-9 članova koji ima predstavnike iz svih regija. Evo, meni je izuzetna čast da su mi dali tako veliko povjerenje, su izabrali za predsjednicu, jer iz cijele Europe samo dvije osobe su sada u tom izvršnom odboru. Od tema kojima se bavimo su energetika, naravno klima, climate justice, taj aspekt raspodjeljivanja resursa je vrlo bitan, da oni budu ravnopravni, da budu da siromašni, tako je, da pravični budu, da siromašni ne budu zakinuti. Onda program oko hrane, zatim program šuma i bioraznolikost ili biodiverziteta. Zatim imamo program voda koji je zapravo više tema, nije još izrastao pravi program. Otpor ekstraktivnim industrijama, resisting mining, oil and gas industries. I imamo program ekonomske pravde i otpora neoliberalizmu. U tom smislu smo dosta ovako politični, za razliku od drugih okolišnih organizacija, smo tu došli do jedne analize gdje smo zaključili da ako se ne bavimo korporacijama, ako se ne bavimo ekonomskim sustavom, da nažalost nećemo moći zaustaviti ovu degradaciju planeta i okoliša. U Europi postoji Friends of the Europe, što je zapravo mreža europska, ali ima jaki ured u Briselu, jer nam je tamo sjedište Europske komisije i dosta se radi kampanja fokusiranih na europsko zakonodavstvo. Tako da kroz taj dio mreže možemo utjecati na europsko zakonodavstvo, što smo dosta i činili. Vrlo su bile jake kampanje, recimo, kod genetički modificiranih organizama, gdje je razlog zašto Europa ima ovaj restriktivni zakonodavstvo usporedi recimo s Amerikom i drugim nekim zemljama, upravo zbog pritiska civilnog društva, a Friends of the Europe je bio jedan od vodećih u tome. Evo, ja bih to ukratko, možete me više pitati ovih dana, ima i na web sajtu dosta informacija. Ono samo što da kažem, s obzirom da dolazim iz ove regije, voljela bih da u budućnosti imamo i više članica jakih, dobrih, kvalitetnih u regiji, znači u ovim zemljama Balkana i nadam se i Turske. Ali nećemo se žuriti, nego ćemo početi ovako suradnjom, pa kako, kojim brzinom ćemo moći ići, ćemo ići.
Hvala svima, ispred fondacije Heinrich Böll. Za neke od vas koji znate, već 15. godina djelujemo u regiji kroz urede u Zagrebu, Beogradu i Sarajevu. Heinrich Böll Stiftung je zelena njemačka politička fondacija koja u ovaj projekt nastoji unijeti rezultat jednog procesa koji je lansiran prije nekoliko godina i kroz nekoliko mjeseci se nadamo da ćemo moći nekoliko studija o ekološkoj transformaciji u zemljama Zapadnog Balkana predstaviti široj javnosti. Preliminarne rezultate na neki način ćete već vidjeti ovdje sutra, gdje ćemo govoriti o studijama koje se tiču involviranja energetike u jedan poduhvat ekološke modernizacije u regiji koji bi mogao imati pozitivnu privrednu bilancu. S druge strane, naravno u sferi prirodnih resursa, pitanje poljoprivredne politike i moguće ekološke modernizacije u poljoprivrednoj politici u zemljama Zapadnog Balkana. To je nešto što je mobiliziralo veliki dio resursa HBS-a unazad nekoliko godina, a neki od vas poput Zelena akcije i Cekora su bili pojedinačno involvirani u taj proces. Te ćemo, nadam se, vidjeti gdje smo sada sa tim i na koji način je najbolje rezultate tog procesa predstaviti i koristiti u zagovaranju određenih rješenja u ta dva sektora.
CSEP is a network of 17 partners. It's funded from the same European project that ETA is funded from. It includes two NGOs in each country in Stare Sefarije, plus Albania, minus Slovenia. That's how we describe it. We're focusing on advocacy through an energy model and policy documents. And so far, with a paper brilliantly written by Pippa from CBankWatch, with contributions from each NGO in the region, I think we've had a good impact on the bank's thinking. And we'll do another one next year on corruption, and at the end of next year, one on the legal frameworks for EIAs and SEAs. The energy model that we're doing is based on UK model from the Department of Energy and Climate Change. It's called OPERA. We thought it was going to be easy to collect the data to do an input-output model on energy and have one in public so people could go on the website and see what, if someone builds a coal plant in Montenegro, what's it going to do to the air quality, to the amount of energy. But it's harder than we thought, it's taking longer than we thought to do that part. But it will be finished, at least the consumption side of the data model and part of the production side by a big conference in April next year, which we hope will be opened by the Commissioner Hedegaard, the Climate Action Commissioner, in April. And if anyone wants to know, I think that's enough, isn't it? If anyone wants to know more things about the project, we have lots of partners in the world.
I'm Piotr Trzaskowski from the European Climate Foundation. I'm based outside of the region in Warsaw, Poland. We are not like a traditional NGO. We are a philanthropic organization, a grant-making organization. We support NGOs, and we are here to support your work here in the region for the protection of climate. And you will hear more tomorrow on the presentation.
Hi, I think a lot of you already heard about Bankwatch, but we are a network of organizations in Central and Eastern Europe. We are 16 organizations in 14 Central and Eastern European countries. And we are primarily made up of national organizations which are environmentally based, although we also try to work a bit more on some social issues as well. And our goal is to make sure that international development finance, which is coming into the region, goes towards projects which don't harm the environment. So in practice, we spend a lot of our time firstly trying to stop harmful projects. Natasha already mentioned the recent success with Kolobara B, and Luca already also mentioned with the Ombla hydropower plant in Croatia. Those are two of the successes for this year in which Bankwatch was involved in supporting the local groups. And we are also trying to change the policies of the bank to exclude harmful lending. So I will be talking a bit about that later on today, so I won't go into that more now. Thanks.
Yeah, I am Maja Stilina, and I'm with the European Environmental Bureau. Actually, I started my environmental career with Friends of the Europe, so that was last century, and today it's not really long. So, European Environmental Bureau is another very big network. We count more than 140 organizations throughout Europe. It mainly focuses on the EU environmental policy, but it also covers much more than that, because environment is included in many other dossiers. I will mention that tomorrow as well in my presentation, so just briefly. So we, and a difference with Friends of Earth Europe, we are not limited to one national organization. So if organizations who are small, working on specific issue, I want to join us, so they are free to join, so we don't have this limitation. What we do, as I mentioned briefly, we are covering all areas of the EU environmental legislation. We also cover agriculture, energy, transport in a bit, and in that we, of course, work in coalitions with different other organizations. We see ourselves as advocacy, lobbying, working with EU institutions on all levels, also national governments, to make legislation better when it starts to be developed, and then follow after the legislation is in place. And we also are trying to make voices of citizens and public to be heard by the decision makers. So that's very briefly, but tomorrow I will, this afternoon already, sorry, we'll show you a few slides what we do more. Thank you.
Greenpeace inače organiziran putem nacionalnih i regionalnih ureda. Mi pripadamo regionalnom uredu u Beču. Taj regionalni ured ili regionalna organizacija obuhvaća 8 zemalja, od, ne znam, Austrije i Poljske do Slovenije i Hrvatske, Bugarske, Rumunjske i tako dalje. Za sada nemamo plan širiti se istočnije u ovom dijelu svijeta, ali se ja nadam da ćemo u dobroj budućnosti i to učiniti. U Hrvatskoj smo prisutni prvenstveno na dva područja, energetika i klima kao jedno i ribarstvo kao drugo područje. Član smo ili sudionik kampanje koju je Luka spomenuo protiv Plomina C na ugljen. Zelena akcija nam je tu kao Zelena Istra glavni partner, otvoreni smo naravno za suradnju i sa drugima. Ribarstvo je jedno važno područje i za Greenpeace i u Europi i u svijetu, pa tako i u Hrvatskoj s obzirom na more. Neko sljedeće područje koje pretpostavljam da će u kojem ćemo se angažirati je poljoprivreda, ali s obzirom na ograničene kapacitete, dakle za sada jedna osoba plus nekoliko volontera i u nekoj perspektivi još dvije do tri osobe, dakle koliko nam ti kapaciteti budu omogućavali, toliko će se angažirati, ali osim ova dva područja koja sam spomenuo, predviđam nekako da ćemo se uključiti aktivnije u poljoprivredu u sljedećih godina.
Dakle, meni je čast biti u društvu ovih aktivnih organizacija koje imaju budžete i staff i djeluju. na vrlo jedan dnevnoj bazi na mnogim projektima. Naime, SINET je bio pokušaj uspostave regionalne suradnje na temu energetike i transporta, koji je bio vrlo aktivan tokom trajanja projekta, a nakon toga smo spali na jedan, ajmo reći, konzultativni mehanizam gdje se nas nekolicina koji se bavimo energetikom i na jednoj regionalnoj razini pokušavamo dogovarati i koordinirati aktivnosti. Ovaj projekt ETNAR je zamišljen da nastavimo inicijativu sa SINET-om i vidimo kako na najkvalitetniji način poboljšati uvjete regionalne suradnje, da li ostati tematski orijentirani ili imati jednu širu platformu za više tema. To su neka od pitanja i dilema koje ćemo, nadam se, na ovoj konferenciji raspraviti.